My topic is international cross-cultural management with a focus on cultural dimensions, and my case studies, they are from Arab world. We'll talk about the concept history and then international management, international cross-cultural management, culture, and then we will talk about strategy for international cross-cultural management or cultural dimensions, and also about the stereotyping, misunderstanding, and challenges and solution, and then case studies and references. Okay. Because of time, I need to be a little bit fast. As I told you, my field is business and strategic planning. And maybe you know a strategy is something like the previous speaker, she talked about art. It's something like art, because when I ask my student always, can you explain what means a strategy? They talk about some different things, but they cannot exactly say what means a strategy, because a strategy is like art, and when you hear this word, then you see, you understand, but when you want to explain, it's very difficult to explain. That's why today, in business, in different cultures, people, they work together. And we say the management of business operations for an organization that conducts business in more than one country is international business or international management. Because maybe you also heard the word global or globalization. That's for whole world, but we talk about international, for more than one country or one culture. Normally, private companies, they do international business or international management because of the financial benefit, but the governmental sector, they do because of the political reasons or political benefits. I will show you some international companies very fast here. You know them, they are very famous. These are some famous international companies. And I showed you them because I want to say my presentation focuses on business. We look at business culture, and we look how we can focus on culture in the field of business, because maybe some companies, some countries, they think if they want to do business, culture is not so important. Or if it is important, sometimes they can ignore some details. But in this presentation, you can see it's not possible to ignore anything. We will talk about international management because today you can see you are from different countries. You are in Germany. That means you need to work in one international company or one local company with some other people from other countries, other cultures. And that means you need to understand them. You need to have some ideas about their cultures, how they think, how they believe, and that's something very important to go to international business, because if you want to have more benefit, you need to go to more risk in the international business. We want to talk about very fast about the history of management. Maybe you know very early writing on management. Some people like Hammurabi, Roman senators, Sun Tzu in China, Marcus Aurelius, and Machiavelli. And also in the 17th century, after the Industrial Revolution, Adam Schmidt. I show you the photo of these people, Hammurabi, Sun Tzu, Marcus Aurelius, Machiavelli, and Adam Schmidt. And also in 1900 to 1930, some people, they moved from different sectors to management, like Henry Fayol. He was on mining engineer, and he moved to management, and he found in management we have six functions, and if they want to do some, you know, technical thing with the people, they cannot only look at the technique and look at the, you know, the engineering field, because they are people and they are not machine. That's why he found management is six functions. And then the next person was also another engineer, Frederick Taylor. he was also a mining engineer, and he looked at the management from the scientific view. And then some people from the mathematics and statistics also, they found they look at the management from another view, if they want to calculate something, if they want to estimate something, because in strategic planning they need to estimate the future. That's why they look at this from another view, mathematics, Walter Schwartz. And also some other psychologists from the psychological sector, they look at the management, and they found human resource is very important, and if they want to get success, they need to move to this, especially when they talk about international business through the cultures. Elton Mayo and Mari Parker. Here we have eight theoretical perspective of international management. This is not our topic, that's why we pass very fast. Intercultural negotiation, intercultural communication, international teamwork, international strategy, international business environment, international HRM, intercultural leadership. Our topic today is focused on this part, international business environment, because we look at the business culture. Here also we have some factors they influence international management, and we focus on this factor, culture. Here you can see legal system, state and political system, geography and climate, economy, taxation, culture and religion. You know, for example, I talk about this one for you because I have been living, as I told you, in Denmark. Maybe you know Denmark has the highest tax in the world, you know, among the countries. And people, when they work there, they need to pay so much tax. And sometimes when they have very high income, they need to pay tax something like up to 75%. Okay, when you are from one country, for example, in Middle East, you want to do business with country like Denmark, you need to think about tax and taxation, because they have special tax system. And if you want to get benefit, you need to think in your country, maybe tax is 15%, but in Denmark is 60%. And maybe, you know, you estimate wrong if you don't look at this factor. Or culture, or legal system. Now we will focus on culture. International cross-cultural management. For this, we need to understand at first, what is culture? As I told you, 10 years ago, I didn't believe culture is very important and in future can be in my field. And that time, a strategy was very interesting for me, because I was thinking about everything from engineering perspective and engineering view. But after I found a strategy, that was so interesting for me. But after some time, I found culture is something very interesting. And as I told you, culture can eat strategy as a breakfast. You can see culture is very strong and very important. Okay, what is culture? Many people, they can say culture is something about habits, how you believe, how you think. And of course, they are all correct, and culture can change your behavior, and you can behave in different situations according to your culture. Now I want to show you some points belong to culture. Number one, language. When you are in Germany, you need to speak German. When you are in Denmark, you need to speak Danish. When you are in new country, new culture, you need to speak in that language, because if you want to communicate with people, the first thing you need is language. That's why language is very important. And today, at the end of my presentation, I will show you one case study. Only because of language, one company, they did fail in the business. You know, sometimes language is very easy, but some, you know, details, they are very important. We need to think about them. Next one, religion. Religion also is very important. For example, I was advisor for the Minister of Energy and Infrastructure in Mecklenburg-Vorpommern Federal State of Germany. When they wanted to travel to my country, I told them, listen, in my country, they are officially Muslim. If you want to go there, if you want to have business meetings. For example, you cannot shake hands with a woman because this is Islamic country and this is religion. If you do this, you lose your business. They said, really? I said, yes. Maybe for you it's very simple, but for them it's very important point. Working schedule. This is also important. For example, in Germany it's from 8 to 4, for example. In Denmark it's from 10 to 2. In your country it's from one time to one time. This working schedule is different in different countries and different cultures. This is also part of culture. Food. Food also is culture. You eat something, I eat something else, and she eats something else. That means people from different countries, different cultures, they have different food. And food is one part, one important part of culture. In many, I was involved in many different multicultural food celebration, and I saw different food from different cultures, and that was so interesting for me. But in another view, if you want to look at the business view, also this is important. For example, if you are Muslim, I invite you to my business meeting, I should ask you what you want to eat, or I need to know, for example, you don't eat pork, you don't drink alcohol. This is something according to the food. Okay, because of time, I do a little bit fast. Medical care, folk art, celebrations, clothes and dressing, manners, jokes, children, buildings. They are all, different points or factors belong to culture. When we talk about culture, that means we need to think all this stuff. Because the first video I showed you, I will discuss at the end of this presentation, is also, according to these points, culture. In culture also we have iceberg of culture. That's also very important because, as you know, something like 30% is visible and 70% is invisible. That means in culture also we have visible part of culture, invisible part of culture. Because some people, they think if they know the language, that means they know the culture. That's completely wrong. Because language is something, from the visible part of culture. But there are some other things, like belief, values. You don't know these things. And if you want to know these things, you need to, study, you need to have advisor. Exactly for this, I could get job, according to this iceberg. When I moved to Germany in 2015, I didn't know any German language. And I found it, because that was exactly the time after sanction lifted up against my country, I found some ministers, they want to travel with delegations to my country. According to this, this photo, I sent email to two ministries and I wrote, you want to go to this country because of these factors, 1, 2, 3, 4, you have some difference, visible business culture and invisible business culture. If you want to do business with them, you need to have one culture, business cultural advisor. Otherwise, you cannot get success. After some days, I got one email from the Ministry of Energy. And they invited me to negotiate. And then we negotiated together and they found, yes, this is right. And then, I started to work with them as an advisor in the field of business culture. That means business culture is very important. Also the normal, when we say business, that doesn't mean only to go to get financial benefits. For example, you are from Arab world, you want to come to Germany and marry with a woman or a man from Germany. From two different cultures, We will discuss in next slides about some points. You think, for example, from your country, collectivism, and that person think individualism. Then if you want to, start a relationship to each other, you need to know there are some differences. And these differences can destroy everything, or if you understand them, you can build something very strong. Then you can see, visible part of culture you can understand very easy in some years, but invisible part is something, very important. If you ask people, they live out of their country more than 30 years, 40 years, they still said, we don't know the culture yet. That means because of the invisible part. There are some core components of culture. power distribution, social relationship, work patterns, and risk, social control. And also communication style, influenced by different cultures and nations. And I discussed it a bit about this table with you, about the Western versus non-Western. Here, you know, when we want to talk about the cultural dimensions, we will discuss more details, but here I will show you something. For example, number two, in Western country, there are internal self-control, and in non-Western country, there are external control. For example, when I was in my country, I was working in the Ministry of Interior, and then every day they control what time we are going to work and what time we finish the work. But in Germany at the moment, I go to work, for example, 8 a.m. and finish my work 6 p.m. But nobody asked me, nobody controlled me, because everyone, you know, follow this one, internal self-control. That means in two different cultures, the system, the business system is completely different. Here, in Western country, time is money. In non-Western country, time is life. Here, in Western country, they focus on tasks, but in non-Western country, relationship. For example, in country like, you know, all Arab world, they are more collectivism. You will discuss what is collectivism. In these countries, they get job, they do their task according their relationship, not according the duties. If I have a good relationship with the minister, I can have a good job, and I don't need to be worried about my task. But in Western countries, they don't care about this. They need to, you know, follow the tasks. Doesn't matter who is your friend, which relationship. That's why I believe in Western countries, they can have high level of HR, human resource, because they don't care where are you from, which culture you have, which religion you have. They said, what is your capability? How you can work? Can you follow your duties? That's very different. Okay, here. In Western country, they look at future and change, and in non-Western country, they look at past and tradition. Another example. I give you this example from my country. As I told you, I'm from Iran. We as Iranians, we talk always about our past. We say, you know, 3,000 years ago, we were very huge, we were very nice, great empire, and these things. But we don't think about today and, you know, our future. And you can see the situation at the moment in our country. What happened and what is going to happen. Okay? In cultural management, cross-cultural management, we have some different studies. 2%, they are very famous and important. Two leading studies of cross-cultural management has been conducted by, number one, he is from Netherlands, and he is a psychologist, and he was former IBM employee. This man, he is very famous in this field because his theory today is a model in cultural dimensions. And then second one is also from Netherlands, and he is a theorist in the field of cultural management. Now we will discuss about this theory, a strategy for international management or cultural dimensions. We will discuss about individualism versus collectivism, power distance, risk, and something not exactly like female and male, but something like that, and long-term and short-term orientation. When we talk about individualism, the symbol of individualism is USA. And when we talk about collectivism, the symbol for collectivism is Japan and China. But if you want to see, for example, the Arab countries, I will show you the result of some study. The the Arab countries, they are more collectivism. But what means collectivism and individualism? Here we have a model from Mr. Yang Liu. This model in the blue side shows you what is individualism, and here is collectivism. In individualism culture or individualistical culture, people, they have relationship. I know him, he knows another person, and we are friends. But in the collectivistical culture, like China, like my country, like most of the Arab world, each individual is connected to a very complex net of relationship. That means you can get job because of your relationship. You can, you know, get success because of your relationship, not because of your abilities. You know, for example, when I was in my country, I had a very good network with different, you know, politicians, ministries, because I have worked in 8 different ministries. When I moved to, you know, Denmark, my younger sister asked me, you know, I want to find a job, but you know, it's not possible. Can you help me? I said, yes. Which kind of job you want? Because she studied environmental engineering. And she said, I like, you know, public relationship, something else. I said, okay. I ran to my friend, he was, you know, former minister, and he said, yes, I can, you know, she can come to my company. Now I have a company. And then they discuss and they employed her because of relationship. But if you don't have relationship, you need to apply, and they say no. They don't care what is your CV, what is your, you know. That's collectivism. And individualism is completely different. I came to Germany, I sent email to ministries, and I said this and that. And they said, yes, come and work with us. You know, I'm a guest professor at Technical University of Berlin. This is a, you know, university, they are focusing on engineering, but I teach them something about how, which kind of, you know, management and cultural skills engineers they need to know. And when I wanted to go there, I sent email and they invited me to an interview, and then they said yes. But if this won't happen to my country, in Arab countries, you need to have recommendation. Not in your hand. One telephone enough. One message enough. Huh? Really? This is collectivism. And this model is very, you know, interesting, that can show you every individual has a big net of relationship. Maybe before we go to next page, I can tell you something here. I was working in the gas company called PGC. And in that company, our CEO wanted to, you know, stop one of the workers because she was not good. And I told him, don't do that. He said, what? I said, this woman, she is, you know, relative of the oil minister. And he said, but, you know, she's not a good person. I don't need that. I said, yes. But if you do, you get complaint. He said, no, I don't care. And then he said, we don't need her to HR department. And after 1 week, the oil minister changed the CEO. You understand? And that woman became in the board of that company. That means net of relationship. In Arabic countries also we have this. But which country more and which country less, we have the, you know, the result of the study and the test for this I will show you. Here we have a map. In this map they try to show you which countries they are more collectivism or individualism. In these green colors, they are more, you know, the individualist index is high. And in orange color, they're medium, and the yellow color is low. That means yellow color, they are more collectivist. And you can see in Asia, most of the countries, they are more collectivist. And in Africa, and also you can see the, you know, most of the Arab countries, they are more collectivism. Some of them, they are a little bit in the middle, like Saudi Arabia and also Turkey. But in South and North America, most of them, they are individualism. Okay, number 2, power distance. The second point we want to discuss is power distance. What is power distance? If you want to say in very simple, short sentence, is distance between you and your boss. If you go to one Arab country and you want to meet a minister, is it possible?
No.
It depends, yes, of course it depends. But as a normal person, it's not possible. But in Germany, I send email to ministry, and they invited me to talk to the minister, very easy. That means that shows us, you know, in individualism or individualistical culture, the power distance is less. And in the collectivistical culture, the power distance is very high. Look, this is a table from that study. I think this table is from 1988. Here we have power distance index, and here we have individualism list. There are some countries, I think it's not visible. Is it visible? No. Here we have some countries, they are in different groups. Here is Germany, Denmark, Austria, they are here. These countries, you can see, they have small power distance, and also they are more individualist. We come here, France, Spain. You can see France and Spain, they have also power distance, but they are a little bit more individualist. That's why I want to tell you something very funny. I have many friends from Arab countries, they live in Europe. And most of them, they move to Spain or France. And when you ask them why, they say, we don't know, but we like this country more. That means because they can see something, you know, near to their culture there. That's why they are here. You can see Spain is also in the middle, not individualist, not collectivist, something in the middle. And if you come here, there are some countries from the South America. They are little bit collectivism, but also with high power distance. And here, there are most of the Arab countries and far Asian countries. They are high power distance and high collectivism. This is a very, very nice, you know, table. And I think you can get this file, yes? They can get this file. I will give you the good quality of this table. You will see. Okay. For example, Italy. Italy is here. Little bit high power distance and individualist. Then you can see if, for example, as I told you, some people, some Arab people, some Iranian, when they are living in Europe, they prefer to live in Spain, Italy, France. Why? Because they feel something is close in their culture. What is close? I told you my example. I told you I have been living in Copenhagen for 5 years. When I moved to Germany, I felt it a bit more easy for me. Why? That was culture, you know? Because I came down in this country, and in this country, I felt something near to my culture. If I go to Spain or Italy, maybe more, because they have also power distance, net of relationship, and the stuff we had before in our country or culture.
Excuse me.
Yes?
The time is running. I really have to
run
because
Okay. How many minutes can I finish?
If you can wrap it up in a few minutes.
Okay. I do very fast. Okay. I showed you the case study. That's a paper I got from the Minister of Energy to be advisor for him. I told you about the story. Here is the next point, risk, and as explained for you, again another diagram. In this diagram you can see when the culture or the country is high individualism, the risk is less. The power distance is less, and if it is collectivism, the risk is high, and the power distance is also high. That's why doing business with Arab countries is always high risk. But if you go to this high-risk business, you have chance to get big success. But if you want to do business in the country like Denmark, individualism, power distance less, but also risk less. When risk is less, your chance to get a big success also is less. Because risk is not only losing. Risk is, is a chance to get or lose something. That's why if you don't lose, you get. That's point number three. Here is a book about this topic. And then the next one is about the society. When we use these two words, sometimes we think this is exactly is about male or female, but it's not exactly like this, because sometimes I'm male, but I think like female. That's why this is not exactly male and female. It's about the social gender roles in different countries and cultures. For example, in Denmark, more than half managers in the field of business, they are women. They are female. But in Arab countries, most of them, they are male. That's, you know, the difference. And also in, you know, in Middle East, the women think this is right, you know? But you know what I mean? The women think that's right. Men should be in this role in our culture and society. Okay? Here is some more information. I need to do faster a little bit. Here is about the quality versus and the quantity of life. When we talk about the quality in the culture, we can think about the Scandinavian countries or style. And when we talk about quantity, is American style, like big food, big hamburger, big car, big house. This is about the quantity. Okay, the question is quality or quantity? And of course, you know, we need both. But how many percentage quantity and how many percentage quality? It depends which culture. That's why after that you can decide. In this culture, 20% quantity, 70% quality. But in another culture, 50-50. But we need both. And the last one is about long-term or short-term orientation. Is a focus of on the future, present, or past. You know, when I was in Denmark, maybe you also read in the news, Scandinavian countries, they have happiest people in the world.
Yes.
Or sometimes they said Danish people, they are first. Always that was question for me, what means they are happiest people? When I was there, I found exactly why. You know, I have three neighbors. And they did something, and I followed, and I found why they are happiest people. Exactly because of the long-term orientation or short-term orientation. In Arab countries, people always, they are busy, they are worried for future. Oh, I'm worried for future, my children, this, that, and they always, they are in the, you know, worriedness. But when you go to Denmark, as I told you, my neighbors, they work and they get the salary after the end of the week, and then they spend all money for weekend. Enjoy, finish, and then next week. Maybe some of you said yes, because they have a very good social system, that's why they don't care about the money and they don't care about the future. Exactly, this is about the business culture and business society. And that's why in different cultures, different countries, we have this difference. Here is a map about this. Now we have all these cultural dimensions together in one photo. And here I want to show you something very fast about the countries. When in this diagram we want to talk about the high effect of communication in the culture. You can see the countries like Germany, Scandinavian country, they are very low in the communication, emotional relation. But Arab countries, they are very high. That's something else we have. That's why when we want to talk about culture, and the differences of in the cultures. We cannot say this culture is bad or this culture is good or something like this. No, we need to find some factors that are more positive from different cultures and combine them to be in the multicultural situation. Here we have another point. Okay, then I finished very fast because I need to also talk about one case study at least. Yes?
I mean, half an hour actually, and as I said, our next speaker
is to catch. I only 30 seconds finish, okay? Look at this photo, please. If you remember at the first of my presentation, I told you language is one part of the project, very important. Sometimes some people they. This is a advertisement from Coca-Cola in Arab countries. A man in the desert, this man drinking Coca-Cola and then fresh. But after they did this, they lost the market. And they were wondering why. This is very nice advertisement, why they lost the market. But they found after that, in Arab countries, they write and read from right to left. That's why they thought, okay, this man is running, drinking, and then you can see, that's very simple, very small, but very deep and important. Okay, because of time, I'm sorry, I could not manage the time very well. That was, when I look at you, very positive. That's nice for me to continue. Thank you so much.